you very much, Philippe, for your introduction. We all know the problem. It has been mentioned already. Archaeological geophysics, the scale of it has grown spectacularly in the last few decades. Data acquisition has become faster, processing as well. We can now measure larger areas at a higher sample density. This is a site in Italy, Falerii Novi. And for example, we zoom in a bit on part of it. We can see how dense the archaeological objects are. That's all in some way need to be interpreted. And it's exactly that interpretation that seems not to have been able to keep up with that rapid evolution of the rest of the discipline, since mostly we're still manually delineating the objects as we did 15 years ago. And it's even worse for techniques that are 3D in nature, like GPR or electrical resistivity imaging, where ideally we should produce something like this, which is even more time consuming. And not to forget also the subjective character of this manual interpretation. So people have started, like in remote sensing, but to a lesser degree, I think, in geophysics, have started to look at ways of interpreting the computer, looking at ways of computer-aided object detection. And today I would like to illustrate two tests that I did myself and applied those to data from this site here in Kent in the UK. Bourne Park it is called. And those two techniques were template matching and object-based image analysis. So to start with template matching, again, if the geophysical technique you're using is 3D in nature, like GPR, you get slices at different depths, horizontal slices with information at different depths. And to use a 2D tool like 2D template matching, we need to synthesize the data here into a single slice from which we can work, and that encompasses all the data from the complete depth range that seems relevant to us. So that's a first step. Then we can perform the template matching, and because here the wall anomalies were running to an oblique angle, we of course had to perform a rotation. And here we prefer to rotate the data sets themselves instead of the templates, because it was then easier to run the algorithm and use vertical and horizontal templates of different sizes. So these go from small to big ones, according to the archaeological objects sizes themselves. And so what we calculated was the normalized two-dimensional cross-correlation. All the areas with cross-correlation above a certain threshold are shown in this map here. You can see that there's a lot of objects that do not really have archaeological relevance, as can be seen from the left image. So we had to do a third step, that is a classification. We did a very simple classification, eliminating the very small objects and also the objects that didn't touch any other object. And that gave as a result this image here, where only the dark gray objects are kept. And a few also had to be manually removed to really come close to the image from which we worked. The last step was then the creation of rectangular bounding boxes around those regions of high cross-correlation. And then we can compare it to the manually interpreted data, which is in the lower image. And as you can see, this seems fairly good computer-aided detection. It's fairly similar to the manual interpretation. That can also be derived from the metrics from completeness and correctness, which were both above 70%. Here we calculated that using the area. So we compared the area of the manually detected objects with the area of the total automatically detected objects. That was work I did some time ago, but I now wanted to compare this with a different approach, and that is something that has also been applied in remote sensing already, that is object-based image analysis. And as some of you may know, the first step in this analysis is that you have to segment your map, and the software I used, eCognition, uses what is called the multi-resolution segmentation. So it starts from objects which are only 1 pixel in size, and then it will start merging those initial objects with neighbor objects. And doing that, homogeneity should be maximized. What does that mean, maximizing homogeneity? Well, there are certain criteria in this. This is specific for the software I used, but it comes down to the fact that especially the color, which you can translate by the spectral value in remote sensing or by the geophysical response value, is very important and usually gets the heaviest weight, up to 90%. But there's also the shape, the smoothness, the compactness that can play a role in how the homogeneity of the objects being merged is calculated. And then the whole process stops when homogeneity drops because of the merging, and according to a threshold that you can set beforehand. So this is an example of how this happens. Here I tried to make the segmentation so that it was appropriate also to extract these bipolar anomalies here. So you can, to a certain degree, adjust the process so that it makes the objects that are most meaningful to you. After that first step, you need to classify the objects, and that is happening by means of combinations of objects, of attributes of those objects which have been segmented, and that could be the strength of the geophysical anomaly, or the shape, or the distance between the objects. Here I didn't want to reinvent the wheel and start writing rule sets myself, because for the problem I had, rule sets already existed, had already been developed by Hinterleitner and by Bregenzbauer for respectively extracting small metal objects, so iron debris of modern origin, and also for other archaeologically relevant structures. So I try to use those rule sets and to see in how far they were also applicable to my own data. So to start with the small iron objects of modern origin, there Hinterleitner et al. Use first of all the anomaly strength, so that is there the difference between the positive maximum in the magnetism and the negative trough, you could say, so the difference between those two, as well as the spatial separation between that minimum and maximum. So when I applied this to the Bourne Park data, I first looked for all those minima and maxima. You can see there's a lot within a certain search domain, and then limited all those that were too far from each other. So if the minimum and the maximum were too far away, they were eliminated. Then extended the objects again by adding neighboring objects of a certain magnetic value. And as I think you can see, this pretty well, covers most of the small iron bipolar structures, so most of those can be captured by this this algorithm. For the other archaeological objects, the picture is a bit more complex. There, Pregersbauer et al. Use an iterative approach in which they always look for the anomalies that are below the 5% threshold, which they call negative anomalies, and the ones above the 95% threshold that they call positive anomalies. And then the process goes on. Those percentiles are recalculated in the next iteration using only the still unclassified objects, and like that it goes on. So how did we do this? We also used those two percentiles, so 5 and 95. And for the negative anomalies, so the ones below the 5% threshold, we used two iterations with this here as result. The same we did for the positive anomalies, the positive magnetic anomalies. Here we did four iterations resulting in this image. And then we can put it all together. So we can put the small recent anomalies on the map and also the larger negative and positive anomalies. How does this compare to the manual interpretation? Well, one could say that most of the archaeologically relevant objects have been more or less detected, but one can see that they're not as consistent as the manual interpretation and that they are much more fragmentary. That is also confirmed by the correctness and the completeness, which are really low figures here, below 50%, so not really good. So one could ask if what has already been addressed in the last talks, whether data fusion couldn't help us and whether we couldn't use fused data sets for having better results with this image analysis. And so we used two fused data sets. One was based on a few attributes that were calculated from the GPR data. You can see three attributes here. And then we fused those three attributes by calculating the first principal component, which is this resulting image. Another fused data set was a fusion of the magnetometer, so the magnetic data, and the earth resistance data. And again, we used the first principal component to fuse those two data sets. So these are the two data sets we used to go on with our analysis. For the attributes derived from the GPR data, we again used the same procedure as for the magnetic data with the 95th percentile. So everything that was above the threshold of 95% of the maximum amplitude is shown here. We needed two iterations to arrive at this image here. The same we did for the fused magnetic and resistance data. Here I have to say that before doing that, we had to invert the magnetic data because usually a ditch like this one here will be low resistance, but will also be high in magnetic value. So we inverted the magnetic value so that they were both low values, which was much easier for performing the fusion. So here we're looking mainly for ditches and for pits. And so we again run some iterations, six in this case, to try and find all those negative anomalies in the fused magnetic and resistance data set. We then merged what we had found in the several iterations, and then in the end put everything together. So here you can see in red everything that has been derived from the fused GPR attributes, and then all the rest, the blue and the green, is originating in the magnetic and resistance data set. Again, we can take a look at how this compares with magnetic interpretation, and here it becomes a bit difficult is this good enough? One could ask, is this a good representation of what we have here? It's difficult to say. I think the quantitative measure says that it's not really a good result, but is it a good criterion? That's an important question, I think. So I here come to some remarks as conclusion. So we see a clear difference, I think, between the two approaches in the sense that template matching was successful, one could say. But here we were looking for very specific shapes, that is the linear walls, whereas for the object-based image analysis, results were not so good, but here we were looking for really a variety of different types of objects, for one could say for all that is archaeologically relevant. And here really the low signal-to-noise ratio of geophysical data, which is often characterized by, really fails to detect weak objects. Like, for example, these ditches here, they're really weak. We can see it with our own eyes, but the computer seems to have really a difficulty in detecting it. There are a number of problems. One important one is the absence of clear reference data. What should we compare with? We do not have, as in remote sensing data, direct possibility to go and observe what is in the field. Everything is below the soil, this is buried. So we can only compare with our own manual interpretation, which is in itself a subjective thing. So that's really a problem, I think. A potential is, and that is perhaps the other side of what the problem is that computer-aided detection is more objective, therefore not always better, but it will be more consistent in what it detects. Let me give you an example. Here, for example, this green area here, so that is an area that is characterized by low resistance and low magnetism after inversion, so originally high magnetism. This had not been characterized like that by the manual interpreters, because probably they were overlooking it because of the contrast with the walls just around that area. The computer there will do a more objective or a more consistent job and will include this in the analysis. So all the things that have already been said, data fusion is often a more solid basis, I think, for object detection. Relatively simple applications like the detection of the small metal objects have become feasible already. But other problems have to be tackled. The transferability, and how far is all this transferable to different data sets, to different cases? We don't know, because there's not enough studies being produced. Another important thing, I think, is, and that's a difference with remote sensing, is that geophysical data are often 3D in nature, and how to extend the mainly 2D analysis tools to 3D is perhaps also still a heavy hurdle to take. And last but not least, a lot has been said during the conference already about machine learning, about deep learning, convolutional networks. I haven't tried any of these, but I'm really curious to see whether these approaches can handle the difficulties that characterize geophysical data, that is, that they're so noisy, that they're 3D in nature, and so on. So that's really something that deserves more research. Thank you for your attention.